Bringing in Tom Murphy now to the Morning Rush. Tom, good morning. We spent last segment talking about how Arkansas, since 2012, man, has the worst record in the SEC. Worse than Vandy, worse than Kentucky in SEC conference games. When you hear that stat, can you even comprehend that considering where the program was not even a decade ago?
It's hard to comprehend it because Houston Nutt, I was covering Alabama at the time, but Houston Nutt went 5-5 against Bama, I believe that's right, in his 10 years. And it was a downtime for the Crimson Tide for sure, but, you know, you expect a little bit of a cyclical action, but since the Bobby Petrino era ended, of course, he went 0-for against Alabama, did beat LSU a couple times. They've struggled. And, I mean, they've lost games against Eastern teams that you thought they should have won. They've lost home games against Vanderbilt in that process. I was thinking about the 2015 season today and the loss to Mississippi State. You know, because y'all had that segment a few weeks back about the greatest opponents you've seen in Razorback Stadium, things like that. And Dak Prescott was clearly one of those.
Oh, yeah.
And that 2015 shootout with Brandon Allen and Dak Prescott, the back and forth and the big leads for both teams, and then the blocked field goal at the end. That 2015 team should have beaten Mississippi State and clearly, you know, should have beaten Toledo earlier in the year, but penalties and some other things ransacked that game. But that 2015 team really could have been easily a 10-win team. And so, to me, that's just symptomatic of wins that were left on the table. When you think of, like, the tight games that have come down to the very end, they've lost so many more than they've won. The Tennessee game on the road in 2015, that's an example of the other side of that. They almost tried to give away. I mean, they tried a fake field goal when they were up four, and it failed when, you know, they could have kicked it and gone up seven. But they held Tennessee in that game. But the long and the short of it is there's just been too many games given away. The John L. Smith experiment just kind of imploded on them the first year after Petrino. The Brett Bielema regime didn't quite, you know, come to full fruition. I mean, the recruiting dropped off, and they could not go toe-to-toe with pro-style offenses of LSU and Alabama, who, by the way, towards the end of the Bielema regime were, you know, at least Alabama was trying to evolve into a more modern offense. And so the Chad Morris experiment clearly did not work. There's great hope that Sam Pittman's going to recruit his way out of this and that they're going to get talented quarterbacks and just be more dynamic on offense and get a few playmakers on defense. But it is stunning that in that time period they've had a worse record than Mississippi State and Ole Miss in the West, and, you know, even Missouri and Vanderbilt in Kentucky in the East. And you know, it's not an easy fix, but it looks like to me they're being positive about this and heading in the right direction.
Yeah, looking over this list, here's what amazed me, and this is the difficulty of the league. You know how many out of the 14 schools have winning records in SEC play combined over since 2012?
Five or six.
Six, yeah. I mean, that's how tough this league is. When you look at Auburn, who's sixth amongst those at 34-32, winning 51% wow. of their game is the sixth team on this list. Bama, of course, has won 90% of their games. Georgia, LSU, Florida, A&M, and Auburn are the only teams that are above water, above 500 since 2012 in league play.
Pretty striking. I mean, yeah. Tennessee's been down for this last decade, for sure, for most of the last decade. And, of course, Vanderbilt. I mean, Mississippi State and Ole Miss probably hovering around 40-something percent of SEC wins in that time, but yeah. But the big boys, they're gobbling up, you know, they're beating on the under guys right now. Alabama and LSU have had a nice 10-year run, and you know, we've been doing this a long time. We've seen basically all the teams in this league go up and down. I mean, I've covered Alabama when they bottomed out, I believe, twice in the SEC. Nick Saban has certainly been a game changer in the conference. And everyone else has been trying to chase that. And Gus Malzahn and Gene Chizik have both had up moments at Auburn, the years that they've beaten Alabama, but it's been hard to sustain for them.
Yeah.
As you pointed out, what, two games over 500 in conference play in that time? A little bit stunning. So who knows when the worm will turn and how long this Sam Pittman regime is going to last. But if their first class of signees and the talent that they seem to be attracting is any indication, they're going to get stronger on the offensive line very quickly, and that's going to attract more skilled guys, and then they just got to get better numbers and faster, better numbers on defense and faster across the board.
Well, you touched on it there. My next point was, or question to you was, how do you change the narrative if you're Sam Pittman? Because, you know, if not, this not only becomes history, it becomes prophecy. It becomes a cycle you can't break. So how do you change the narrative? How do you change this cycle if you're Sam Pittman and start back headed in the right direction?
Well, you know, by recruiting like they have been, of course, the COVID-19 thing doesn't help anything, and the potential for lost revenues in the upcoming season, either through cancellation or postponement of games and the crowd capacity being not full. So, you know, these are challenges they're going to have to deal with, but I think in a quarterback like Felipe Franks, you keep him protected and you run an offense that is schemed for him to get the ball out quickly, for him to run it some, because that's the component. I mentioned it a couple of times with you guys, but that's the component they were really missing under Chad Morris. Their quarterbacks weren't able to run, which, you know, make up for lack of protection, which turned bad plays into good plays at some point. It really changes the complexion of your offense when you can convert a third and three, when your quarterback just is able to squirt out and get 5 yards on, you know, on a broken play. So I think the improvement in O-line that we expect this year, that first of all, it's a veteran line, one of the most veteran lines coming back in the SEC. They should be better, and they're going to get pushed by these young guys that Arkansas has recruited. And I think the combo of Felipe Franks and KJ Jefferson, who had his moments against Mississippi State, I mean, we just got very brief glimpses, but if he gets his passing accuracy down, we know he's a dual threat. So if you improve at quarterback, you got a guy like Rakeem Boyd, he's already shown an 1,100-yard rusher, can get the ball in the end zone, you know, can break away like the Kentucky game. I think it was the first snap. You break away and you outrun guys in the secondary, and maybe you break a linebacker's tackle, and then you outrun guys. I mean, that's a quality that very few backs in this league have. So, you know, they should be better in 2020. And then if they keep recruiting like they are, you know, you start beating the Ole Misses and Mississippi States and your cross-rival Missouri, and then maybe you can move it up from there and really challenge the Auburns, A&Ms. And, of course, I'm going on another tangent here, but the A&M series alone just kind of shows you they should have won three, maybe four of those games in the last several years, mm-hmm. but they didn't win any of them. All right.
Tom, you bring up 2015. One of the teams they did play in 2015 was Texas Tech, who had Patrick Mahomes. I know you probably saw this yesterday. Dude got paid, could get up to $500-something million. Probably not going to get that much, but somewhere in the ballpark of the 400s. What did you think about that contract announcement yesterday that made waves?
Yeah, it's just crazy numbers. It's hard to even comprehend. And I am a huge Patrick Mahomes fan. I mean, Arkansas handled that team in 2014 down there when Davis Webb was the quarterback, and he was a solid quarterback, but Arkansas just went down there and ran all over them. Okay, so they're marginally better on defense the following year, but Patrick Mahomes was the X factor when they came in here and they jumped on top and just kind of never let up. Very motivated team, but Patrick Mahomes was a huge difference maker. So anyway, other than the Falcons, the Chiefs now are kind of my AFC team. Big fan of Patrick Mahomes. I think I would say that at this point they're probably overpaying him because that's just mad money. And who knows how this will all end up. But I'm happy for him because I think he's a good kid. And I wish him and the Chiefs some success.
So what happens next with, like, Dak Prescott and Deshaun Watson? What do you think Jerry does next following this move with the Chiefs that they've made with Patrick Mahomes?
Well, Dak Prescott has been doing it longer, but I don't think he's not doing it better. Nobody is doing it better. His ability to make throws in strange positions, to turn bad plays into good plays, to run, all those things make him the top quarterback in the league right now. And so Dak Prescott should get a big salary, but you can't pay him Patrick Mahomes numbers.
No, absolutely not.
$40 million a year? what does
I don't
he get?
Know, man.
I mean, something's got to happen quickly with Prescott, right? Sooner rather than later, obviously. If not, the franchise tag gets put on.
Right, and you know, I don't know all the details about what would happen this coming year if he doesn't sign, but
I think the tag's 31.5, I believe it is.
Well, I hope they get it. You know, I like Dak, and his first year that he was the starter, that was a phenomenal year for the Cowboys. They haven't been quite able to, you know, sustain the run game that really fueled that season. But the potential is there. I mean, they lost a lot from that O-line, but with Zeke and Dak, the potential is still there. But I don't know. Sometimes your windows in the NFL can be pretty narrow. And, the Cowboys need to get something done pretty quick.
So I know you're probably excited to see, Tom, that Isaiah Joe is still on the roster at Arkansas. They updated it with different heights, different weights, the numbers and stuff yesterday. We've had this conversation. I know Eric Musselman has said there's no timeline on his decision as far as what him and his family are going to decide to do with his future. The deadline from the NBA as far as the early entry is August 3rd. So when do you anticipate, if you had to pinpoint a day or a week, when do you anticipate him making a decision with his future, Tom?
Yeah, it's really hard to speculate, but I would say a lot closer to August 3rd than maybe today. But, you know, this has been a long process, and you have got to think that he has a pretty good indication. He's had numerous Zoom meetings with NFL people or NBA people, and you'd like to think that they have a pretty good idea of what they're going to do, and that notifying Eric Musselman and the Razorbacks would be a good thing to do so they can start – you know, preparing for what the 2020-21 season is going to look like. But I really don't have any inside knowledge on when that might be made.
Tom, last question before we let you go. Tony Bua is going to be joining us at 8 o'clock this morning. We asked Clay his favorite Tony Bua stories. Does one, and I know you weren't covering him at the time, but he did go to Alabama, did play those games. Does that name ring a bell? Does that guy resonate with you at all?
Oh, of course. I mean, just a scrapper, a guy, a spark plug kind of dude who just played bigger than his size. And I saw the clips y'all put out. I mean, he recovered the fumble in that massive Kentucky overtime win. I remember one time, I think they played, this is a double overtime game maybe at Alabama, and they ended up winning it. You can ask him about them being overtime kings. And I think he made contact with a referee, and this was at Alabama. And I'm not sure if they threw a penalty flag or not, but it was amazing to see. He did not like a call or something, and there was contact, and he might have gotten a 15-yarder, but not an ejection. And I think this was a game that Jamar Gallen intercepted Brody Croyle, and Alabama maybe missed a field goal in overtime. My mind's a little bit murky. Maybe 2003. And Arkansas won the game, double overtime. So
I think Chris Balsaro kicked the game-winning kick.
Molding off the one as he's walking off the field.
And I remember watching that guy. I remember that. For whatever reason, that fact stands out to me. We're talking about the same game. But Alabama Stadium was under construction. There was a weather delay in that game. And Balsaro in the double overtime, and Balsaro wins the game on the game-winning kick. So.
Yeah, I think you're absolutely right on there, Tommy. And 2003 is the number that sticks in my head.
That sounds right.
And I think Arkansas came back from a large deficit. It's a little bit similar to the 2007 game where I think Arkansas scored 3 touchdowns in a row. Details are a little murky, but, yeah, that was the game. And Bill was a key dude in that one for sure.
Tom Murphy of the Arkansas Democrat Gazette joins us every Tuesday and Thursday. Tom, really appreciate it, buddy. We'll talk in 2 days.
You betcha. Sounds good.